for years, you tried many times, and finally you achieve what you've been trying to do many times. And I don't call that luck. It's by purpose. You are achieving exactly what you have been trying to do for a long time. It's like a business. You cannot do business by luck. You have to have a plan, you have to have a target, and you try to achieve it. And like this picture, you cannot take this picture by luck, because it needs a lot of planning. You need to have equipment who can actually take this. This is with underwater housing and also special lens. I will talk a little bit more about it later, but it has to be planned. You have to test it, you have to train, you have to advance, you have to make it better and better, and finally you get what you want. Purpose is also about awareness. It's about having the knowledge of making the pictures you are dreaming about, thinking about, trying to achieve, and also the ability to use that information to make the picture. So it's not only to be aware of it, but you need to know when and in certain situations can you actually do it. So this is a situation I've been thinking about photographing. You heard about the tip of the iceberg, but actually to visualizing how much is below the sea, it's not very easy to do. You need, of course, underwater housing, but you also need a certain size of the ice. You need clear water, the different things that might that has to happen before you can take it. And one very important thing about purpose is to be ready. If you don't know when things are happening, maybe something is happening, you see something great happening, but you're too late. Eagle is flying down and catching something, you take up the camera and it's gone. You need to be in advance. That's key to wildlife photography. 2, 3, 4 seconds, or maybe a little bit more before, you need to be ready. Otherwise, you will lose the situation, and you can say it's unlucky, but it's maybe that you don't have the time to prepare, you were not ready. So as a photographer, photography by purpose is like being in a room and playing with darts. You know you have a target, and you're trying to hit the bullseye to get the highest score. But if you don't, if you just do it by accident, by luck, it's like the coming into the room blind, you don't know where the board is, you're just throwing the dodge, and maybe you hit, maybe you get some points. It's just by luck. And if you also have experience, if you're training every week or every day, your chances to get the higher score is also better. So that's a little bit of how I think about photography. It's about to have a target, have a purpose, and trying to achieve it. So photography by purpose is actually three stages. It's about what you're doing before you take the picture. It's about planning. Second, it's about what you're doing in the field when you have the camera. And third is what you're doing after you're coming home. What's your purpose about using the picture? So all these three has to work together. Because you can be the best planner in the world, have the best equipment, but if you're never in the field, you don't get the pictures. If you spend all your time in the field but don't have the knowledge, don't have the equipment, you might lose everything. And also it's very important to know what you are going to use the picture for. Then it's more easy to achieve it. So if you start with planning, one of the most important things is to know where to go, and when to go. And the most easiest way is to Africa. It's a lot of wildlife. You know, we have all day. Animals, birds, you can photograph every second if you want. But for me, when I was preparing this presentation, I suddenly realized that I don't have any pictures from Africa awarded. I'm very happy with some of my pictures, but sometimes you need to visit places that's not over photographed, which are have different qualities, and I will show you three of my secret spots. I'm not saying you're not going to Africa, because it's great, it's really great. And also, don't forget your backyard. It's a lot of great photo opportunities in your neighborhood or 1 hour driving distance from here. It's very important that your photography is not only about flying as long as possible away from Dubai to get the pictures. Don't forget your home area, your roots, your history, your culture. It's also important. But the three places I will show now is the places I've been visited the most last 3 years. And also, if you look at my successful picture, that's maybe 90% is from these kind of secret areas. And the first is Alaska, Katmai. And I was actually living here 22 years ago. For a year, I was studying in the university. I was studying natural resource management, economy, politics, and photography. That's a nice mix. And I heard rumors about a place where the grizzly bears, where you can get close to them, lot of fishing, salmon, lot of activity. But as a student, I didn't have the budget to do it. I never hear the name. I knew it was in Katmai someplace, but it's quite a big area. It's a national park. But 6 years ago, I became friend with a guide who is guiding in this area. And he told me there is one river where the BBC did their grizzly bear filming. I'm not sure if you've seen it, but it's a lot of splashing, lot of underwater shots, clear water. And he told me he knew about that place. So I was very excited, because maybe it exists. It was like a rumor, but now I had the chance to visit it. And in 2015, Nikon called me, Tokyo, asked me if I wanted to test the Beta D5. And I also asked me, is there any places where we should go to test it? And I said, yes. I know about the place. I've never been there. But it should be the ultimate test for the camera. And actually, they agreed. So we went there for 1 week. I had a film team with me. And it was also part of the official kind of commercial for the D5 camera. So I will just show you a short version about this, where you can see the river I'm talking about. Oh, there is no sound here. Wait a second. I just need the sound.
Myself a photographer, and photography means you try to capture the one perfect moment, to tell the story in exactly one frame.
every single picture I take is personal. Every image matters.
I think it's very important to be hungry and creative, you know. If you lose the hunger for perfection, you also lose the edge as a photographer.
I'm always striving to create better and better images.
Motorsport photography is our life. And for this reason, after 30 years, is a passion too.
I prefer to be in the field, to see it live and with my own eyes, and then it's also more interesting, you know, to take the pictures also. Alaska in end September, beginning October is quite extreme regarding wind, rain and cold. For me, cameras and lenses are tools. I'm not thinking much about droplets on the camera and if they get dust or dirty, or I work hard with equipment. Like the grizzly bear, some people think they are monsters and some think they are pets. But I want to show the real life, the real way of living. At some point you start to build bonds to your subjects. Very important in my photography to be on their level, low in the water like the grizzly bears, and see it through their eyes or look in their eyes close, an intimate feeling.
Yeah, so that was a short version. So the river exists, and since that was in 2015, I've been every year back to this river in September. And the reason is, it has a lot of potential because it's a very small stream and it's very shallow. So everywhere where the bear are running, it's potential for a lot of splashing. I like water splashing and especially backlight. Water and backlight is nice. Here the camera is almost in the water. It's not the underwater housing. But when you get low enough, you get the reflection like this. Another advantage with shallow water, like 10, 20 centimeter, is that you can see the fish. You see where the bears are actually heading. Because one problem when you're photographing action, if you don't know the direction, it's very difficult to follow. You know, they're exploding. If you don't know the direction, you will lose the shot. But here you can see the fish just swimming away, and you can more easily follow. And the third thing is the water quality. Even with hundreds of thousands of fish, the water is still clear. Usually it's murky, you don't see anything under. And that makes opportunities for split photography, underwater photography. And as you saw in the movie, I was wearing a diving suit 12 hours a day. I was in the water. But it's also possible to do it without. Like Saji was with me last year. And was it cold? It was cold, yeah. So it's not recommended, but it's very shallow. And also the landscape, that's also great. That adds something to the picture. And you can see how shallow. It's almost so you think it's no fish can go up. So this makes this place perfect for at least what I want to do. Action, water splash, grizzly bears, and the other thing is the late river, so the bears are aggregating. Even with very little fish as we had last year, we still have the bears. And in the video, I was in a tent and it's raining and blowing, you know, it's cold. You cannot store your camera gear. And now we use the ship, so it's much more convenient. You can recharge batteries, you can eat a proper meal, you sleep well, you are dry. It makes life easier, even for wildlife photographers. So let's make this one of my three main secret places. And if you ask me, I will not tell you the name of the river, because it's secret. So I call it the Grizzly River, because if I tell you, or if I announce it, in 2 years it will be crowded. Because there are not many, even in Alaska, you can go to Brooks Falls, Lake Clark, and all these famous places, you will not get this. So that's why when you find something secret, you have to be a little bit careful. The second place, which I really love, is Antarctica. There's no other place you can go and have this kind of amazing wilderness, ice, and mountains. The closest is Greenland. But there's something with this area which is really attractive. And I go there usually every year. And the timing is November, beginning of November, because you have clean, white, fresh snow. It's beginning of the breeding season, so you have interaction, you have breeding, courtship, and everything is clean. If you're coming in January, February, you have the chicks, but everything is dirty. It's muddy, dirty for photography. I've been done it in that time. And for photography, it's not very good. So you need to go there on the best time. And the best time is beginning of November. Also because the light is really nice. Like here, the sun is coming. And that's the good thing about joining a trip with photographers. Not tourists, but photographers. You can actually get out early. Before breakfast, you can get the sunrise. You can also get sunset, of course, if the conditions are, if it's not too windy, instead of waiting for a breakfast or a meal that's destroying everything. And also penguins, that's among birds. My favorite birds are owls and penguins. There's something with penguins, they are the most human-like birds. They're walking on two legs. They also have kind of the family, they invest a lot of energy in their chicks. King penguins have the chicks for 13 months. That's quite a long time to be a bird. And they also have structure like people. They have towns, they have highways between the colonies and the ocean. And they're also funny. They're also predictable, since they have these highways. So you can find a place, like here I have the backlight, and I know if I wait a few minutes, there will come some penguins here. They're not randomly spread out, they have tracks. And that makes predictable possible, and I like that in photography, to know where things are supposed to happen. Also, as I said, fresh snow, if you mix fresh snow with wind, you get these situations. And you also need backlight, otherwise the snow will not be visible. Light, it's very difficult to find places with this amazing red. You have it other places, but you have it maybe for 5 minutes. In Antarctica and also in the Arctic, it can last for an hour or maybe 2 hours. It makes it much longer for photography in the golden light. And last but not least, you have these amazing structures. It's not as high as the building on the side here, but the volume is amazing. It can be 1 or 2 kilometers. So don't find icebergs like this other places in the world. So for me, this is one of the three places I visit as a photographer as often as possible, because it gives me totally different pictures than most other photographers are taking. And I also like this environment. The third and last is in Svalbard. Has anyone know about Svalbard, heard about Svalbard? You have? Anyone been there? Saji, you've been there? Good. This is the most northern city in the world, 78 degrees north. Only 2,000 people, 78 degrees north. The good thing is there are 2 or 3 daily flights every day with nice planes. It's easy to access. And only just outside city, you have Arctic wildlife, like Arctic fox, reindeer, birds, and also if you extend by about 2 hours, polar bears. And wild photo, as I told about, we have a gallery here in this building. That's the most northern gallery in the world at 78 degrees north. So if you're going to Svalbard, please visit our gallery. So this is one of the situations you can have in winter. The light is really nice, and you have ice, glaciers, and hopefully also a polar bear. This is only 2, 2.5 hours with a ship from Longyearbyen. Glaciers, some people say, you know, this is not the real color. This is Photoshop. But it's sometimes you have to desaturate because it's so intense. The blue ice, this might be 10,000-year-old compressed ice, and the color is insane. What's happening? Just have a technical break. No, yeah, good. Thank you. So this blue color is just like a big piece of art. So that's one of the reasons why I visit this place as often as possible, because there are always some new opportunities. And also, this is the only place in the world where you find polar bears which are not hunted. In Canada, Greenland, Alaska, and also Eastern Russia, they are killing polar bears. And of course, the bears are afraid. Svalbard, they are used to humans, and they can get quite close. Of course, you don't want them too close. So it's kind of a, you have to a little bit distance away. And also, even if it's almost at the North Pole, there are millions of seabirds. Lots of bird activity. And to reach these areas, we use a small icebreaker. It's not a luxury boat, but it has everything we need to visit the areas with polar bears and all the wildlife. So this is just to give you an idea about the planning. You know, when I do my photography, these are the three main places. Of course, there are other also, but there's some special potential here. Here, between March and September. So it's not one. In the winter, it's March, April. And then the summer season is best from maybe mid-July to beginning of September. And the reason why we don't do trips in May is it's like off-season. It's not winter, it's not summer. And June is also the month with the highest sun. The light quality is it's not harsh, you know, it's not harsh, but if we're going a little bit further out in summer, the sun is going lower and you have this amazing midnight sun setting. So that's, at least for me, that's when I usually go. I always go there 15th to 25th of July. That's the place where I always want to be a guide on that time. So that's what I want to talk about where to go and when to go. But you also need equipment. And in Vaila Photography, I mostly use 600 millimeter. Here I use 600 and 1.4 extender, because the wildlife have a tendency to be a little bit far away. And this is the orca. This is actually the most northern observation of orca in the world at 82 degrees north. So that's the only time I've seen orca in Svalbard, but it was the most northern world record. The nice thing about a long lens is you enlarge, you get quite close anyway, and you also have some blurred foreground and background. But sometimes the wildlife is too close. So that's a problem also. A telephoto lens at 300 here is sometimes too big. And the thing here is, you know, in Svalbard, it's not allowed to feed the animals. It's tempting to use sausage to attract the foxes. It's not allowed. But there are no rules telling you to wash your fingers after eating sausage. So I always have a lunch with sausage, and I have a lot of fat on my fingers. So you see the eye, it's not looking at me, not looking at the camera, it's looking at the finger. So that's kind of a trick if you're going there. The problem, if it's too much fat, you cannot use the wheel, you know, it's just here, the wheel, so that's a problem. So at 300 millimeter, I usually use it for flight situations, but now I use the 4.0, because 2.8, if you do this for hours, you get very tired or get very strong, usually tired. So I use a 4.0 because it's lighter, easier to use. And now with the mirrorless cameras, they're even smaller, even lighter. But in my photography, I like to include landscape. This is a 7-200 millimeter lens, a zoom lens. And instead of just framing the penguins, I also include some of the landscape. And with the 7200, you also have the ability to zoom, use from 200 to 70. And that's one of my favorite lenses. Or when I want to include even more, 24 to 70, in this kind of landscape. You see the animal in their environment. Sometimes even wider. Again, fox, tendency to get close, 14 to 24. And then you also, even when you're close to the subject, maybe 5 meters away, you can include a lot of the landscape. This is Antarctica. But sometimes I want to have a special effect in my picture. I really like shallow depth of field. Only the eye sharp, everything else blurred. And then I use a portrait lens, 85 millimeter 1.4. And I took this lens with me only for this picture. Eye sharp and also this spot, everything else is unsharp. And this is by purpose. You know, if you want everything sharp, of course you don't use this lens. But if you want this portrait effect, which I like especially on penguins because they're very approachable, then this lens is really, really good. Or 24, 1.4, still have very shallow depth of field, only the head and the front of the eyes, but everything in the foreground and background just blurred out. And of course, this is different, but sometimes different is exactly what you want. Especially if you're submitting to competitions, this is something the jury sometimes like. Not every time, but you can use your equipment to achieve special effects. Also like this guy, 24, 1.4, only eye sharp, everything else blurred. And of course, when you bring a lens with you like this, you shoot wide open. You don't use aperture 11, then the whole point is gone. So this is about planning. You have to plan what kind of equipment you want to bring, because if you don't bring it, of course you cannot use it. And I also recommend, sometimes when people ask, I say, bring your longest lens and your shortest lens and everything in between. But of course, that's a joke. Because if you have too many lenses, too much gear, you just get confused. In the field, you need to know what you are targeting. Otherwise, you're just standing and you're shifting lenses and it's just messed up. So that's one of my advice, to be selective. And both where you go, but also what kind of equipment you bring. And that's actually one of the most important thing when you are in the field, is actually to decide what you're not going to photograph. Because like in the Mara, or also like in the Arctic or Antarctic, there's so many opportunities. And if you're going to shoot everything, you will get tired and you will most likely get a lot of snapshots. So by being more selective, you can focus more on one specific subject and invest more time, and you increase your chance of getting better pictures. So when you're in the field, it's very important also not to only have the equipment, but you need to know how to use it. Because otherwise, it's like to have a great car, but you don't know anything about driving. You will not have any use of it. So camera settings, about how you approach wildlife, how you get different like background, foreground, composition is very important. I mean, I will spend a few minutes now to talk about in the field, how I as a photographer approach my subject, and maybe it gives you some new things you also can use. And first thing is exposure. Aperture, shutter speed, ISO, and if you like also white balance. And I usually use manual mode. And the reason is, if the light conditions is stable, I don't need to overexpose or underexpose. I just set the correct exposure. And then if an eagle like here is coming in front of a dark area, it's okay. Because this eagle was flying toward a bright sky, but I knew at some point he would dive down and catch a fish somewhere here. So before the eagle even came, I took my two camera bodies, I did test shooting, and checked my histogram, and just make sure everything was okay. So both my cameras, both with the long lens and with 7200, was ready before anything happened. So when the eagle came, I took up my camera. I knew exposure is okay. I don't need to do anything about the exposure. The only thing I need to think about is autofocus and following the subject, and also composition. But the thing with action photography is usually to have your subject in the center and then rather crop afterward. Because if you are composing with the autofocus point to the left here, it might be difficult to track. The other situation is like here. It's completely different. It's everything is bright almost, except the black head of this bird. And in this situation, do exactly the same. Manual exposure. I'm checking the histogram and make sure I have some details. You see, the eye is not totally black. There are some details here. Because if, of course, it's possible to use shutter priority or aperture priority, but then you need to use EV plus something or EV minus something. And that's actually more difficult, because then you have to change all the time. If it's in front of something bright, you maybe need plus one or plus two. If it's something in front of dark, you need minus one, minus two. If the light condition is not changing, it's easy. Manual mode. If the light is changing, like here, they are much brighter in this area. That would be on the side here, where there's no reflection from the sun. And also in the back, just 10 meters to the left, there are just shadows in the water, no reflections. In these situations, I usually use aperture priority. And with exposure value zero, usually that's a good start. And I always take some picture in advance before. We knew the fox were over here someplace, and we hoped it will pass in front. We didn't know, but we knew from experience that he usually liked to run in front. So we took some test pictures, and in this situation, aperture priority at EV zero was the setting. Sometimes I actually expose the picture a little bit too dark by purpose. And the reason here is if I would take a perfect exposure, this area would be white, off-white. And I would never get this orange color back in Lightroom. It's gone, completely gone. So I expose for the highlight to make sure I have some orange information in the picture. And then I rather, in Lightroom or Photoshop, I can bring out a little bit lighter in the shadows. With the new cameras now, you know, this picture is maybe 5 years ago. With the new cameras, the dynamic range are even higher. So maybe I could done it without exposing it to darker. And here is opposite. Sometimes I expose a little bit too bright by purpose. And the reason is here is a very bright day. And some photographers say it's not for photography. You know, we just go home and sleep and wait for the sunset. But here I'm exposing a little bit brighter to include, get some information in the shadow. And I accept that the background is just off-white. I also get the reflections here, off-white, but I accept it, and I by purpose expose it a little bit too bright. So when I look in the histogram, there will be in the right, it will be something all the way to the right. It's burned out. But I can see I have information in the shadows. But there is one way of fixing this problem. Maybe not on this sunny day, but at least when you have a sunrise or sunset, when the power of the sun is not that big, is to use a flash. You can see here, I used a flash to just bring out some details in the shadows. It's not only about make this a little bit brighter, but I also get more sharpness. And sometimes you can also see the colors even better. So the flash is good, not only for bringing out details in the shadow. So what I've done here, you see there are no sharp black edges. Sometimes when you use a flash on the camera, it will be a black, very distinct mark between where the flash is and where it's not. But I use a softbox, which I can make very small. And I put it 1 meter on the side. I use a transmitter. And how I do this, I only focus on exposing the picture without thinking about the flash. So I get the background correct. And then I use the flash manually, usually around 1/4 of max power, to just have the fill flash. So I actually don't use the auto functions on flash. You can do that, but I like the old way, the manual power on the flash. So this is just how to balance ambient light with flash. And I use that actually quite a lot because it increases the quality in some picture, and it also extend my photography. This is 1.5 hours after sunset. And at that point, it's too dark for wildlife photography. You can see down here, you know, it's way, way, way too dark. Most people would just go back, have a dinner and rest and wait for the sunrise. But with the flash, you can actually again expose for the background and then use the flash to get the amount of light you need, and also you stop the motion. So you get sharp, even if they're moving and you use a slow shutter speed, you will get a sharp bird here. And this is also from the same, the day before actually. And without the flash, this area would be just dark, boring. But with the flash, suddenly you see it's green color. And you don't see it before you use a torch or a flash, because it's in the shadow. So this is also after sunset. It's too dark to photograph. But with a wide angle and with a flash, you can actually, and it's also handheld, it's not a tripod. The problem here is it's literally in a shower. You know, I was just soaked and I was wiping my front lens every 5th second, but it's everything is just coming into lens. You have this kind of water droplets, but in my opinion, it just adds a little bit more feeling of seriously wet. Some places, they're not allowed to use flash. So what can you do? You can use a LED lamp. So this is in Galapagos. And this is one of the few species I know about who don't like flash. These giant turtles and also some owls, they don't like flash. Nocturnal birds don't like flash. And then it's better to use a LED lamp, which is not so strong. You need to be quite close. and you don't freeze the movement. You see the droplets are moving a little bit and they're making lines instead of points. So it's a little bit different. But you can also use it for like sunrise and sunset situations. Like here, this is a droplet, it's water spray, it's reflections. And I also used a LED lamp to just bring out a little bit of information in the shadows. Otherwise, it would be totally black. And to balance the orange light with the LED lamp, I put an orange filter in front of the LED lamp. So I get orange light on the bird, matching the orange light from the sunrise. And I also have a regulator so I can adjust the power. So I can take the LED lamp close to the bird, I get back to where I should stay with my lens, and then I can just adjust the power of the light. And that's the beauty about LED lamp. You see the result. When you use a flash, it's just a microsecond, and you don't see it before you see it on the live view. One of the most important settings in the field is autofocus settings, especially in wildlife, action photography. It's very important. In this situation, it's quite easy because there's no movement. So it's possible to use autofocus single and one shot called in Canon. And you also have time to have the autofocus point all the way to the left because it's no movement. But the problem is when you have action. Something is moving fast. These guys are flying very fast, and here you also have snow. That makes it difficult because the autofocus have a tendency to focus after contrasty subjects like snowflakes. So in this situation, I tried to have the focus point in the middle, and I also had autofocus lock on. That means the focus is locked on a subject for a certain time before it tries to find another subject to focus. So in Nikon, it's at least, I think it's 1.3 seconds, the longest. And Canon has also feature. What about Sony? I'm not sure about Sony, but usually you can have autofocus tracking that makes following the subject, even if there's something in between. And usually I use autofocus group to have more points working together, because if you only have a tiny point, these birds have a tendency to fly a little bit erratic, and it's difficult to track the bird if you only have one small autofocus point. So I recommend to have more points active to follow the subject. Some of the new cameras also have a flip screen, so you can photograph in live mode and also have the autofocus. But the problem with the DSLR cameras is that it's very slow and it's not very accurate. My experience is about 50% getting sharp and 50% unsharp, even in situation without a lot of movements. But that's one of the biggest advantage with mirrorless cameras, because they are so much better in live view mode, autofocus. Before we take the break, it's about 5-6 minutes too, I will just talk a little bit about panning. Using slow shutter speed to follow, if a bird is flying, I'm following with the lens the same speed as the bird, but I have a slow shutter speed, so I will have motion blur. And then you can get some really nice, almost painting effects. You cannot do this in Photoshop afterward because you need these movements. This is 80th of a second, 80. And that's if your subject is moving fast, hundreds or 80th of a second should be a good setting. Here it's about 50 seconds. It's a little bit more motion blur, but you have head is sharp, and it's actually giving a much more artistic picture than if I would use 2,000 of a second. Everything is sharp, but you've seen that 1,000 times before. No, tripod. With all these are with 600, except the Eagle was handheld in the boat. That's handheld. So this is with 600, and I use a tripod with a video head, a fluid video head. Because then you have resistant. If you use this Wimberly head, it's a little bit too easy to follow. You don't have the resistant. So for this kind of photography, a video head is better because you have a much smoother way of following. So this is 25th of a second, and now you see even more blur on the wings. The head is still sharp if you are lucky. The problem with panning is that the slower shutter speed, the more picture are rubbish. Because if everything is unsharp, it's not that nice. Something needs to be sharp. But the good thing, it's 3 minutes, yeah. The good thing is the background is no more painting, it's no disturbance, and that's why I use panning a lot. Because if I shoot with a fast shutter speed, I get a lot of detail in the background. And in my opinion, it's disturbing. So this is with flying. Slower than 25th of a second, it's very difficult. Usually you get everything blurred. But if you have a mammal walking, then you can have a slower. This is 13th of a second. And this is actually the secret river I talked about. It's actually wolves fishing salmon also. I never knew about that. But 2 years ago, this guy, 3 days, were very close to us and fishing salmon. That's interesting. But here, he's walking in a direction parallel to my camera. And also he's walking quite slow, so 13th of a second made this kind of motion blur, but the head is sharp and the fish head is also pretty sharp. Also a bird who's flapping the wings can also make some nice motion blur. This is also 30th of a second, and you see the water droplets make big lines, and you have quite sharp the bill. But everything else is motion blurred. This is a picture which is, this is handheld. It's 5th of a second. And there are more than 10,000 gulls. And they're flying to the right, the front of the flock. But in the background, you see this white, they're flying to the left. So it's kind of a rotation, and it looks a little bit messy, but I really like pictures that you actually need to invest a little bit of energy to see what it is. And somewhere you see birds that are sharp, but many people don't like it. But this is about pushing the limits a little bit to create pictures that are different. Because it would be easy to photograph this with fast shutter speed and you get the picture you have seen many times. But by using the shutter speed, slow shutter speed, you get totally different. This is a king penguin walking in between penguins resting. So it's kind of playing with colors, orange, yellow, and dark, and just following this gentleman. It looks like a royal with lifted bill, and really nice. So the three last pictures before the break is about kind of landscape shot. This could be a landscape shot, but you see also the herons. They were sitting still for many seconds, and I could use a neutral density 5-stop big stopper filter, 1 second of shutter speed, so I could capture the movements of the waves and also get this blurred ocean, but still get the herons sharp. And this was in November. And even longer, it's about 1.5 second. And the river is, the water is moving, the penguins are not moving, and the rocks are not moving. And it's also a ND5 stop filter, and also a graduated ND filter in top. So this is, for me at least, it's much more interesting to try to make these pictures than take, there are millions of other pictures of penguins. And this landing, I kind of focused on this, and we also had some guests, clients with us, so I tried to also show them this. And here you can use this kind of technique to, for me, this is showing the transition from this world to the next world, or afterworld, or heaven, or what you call it. It's ghost penguins. See, these penguins here are just merging out. Some of them are standing. And it makes something different. And for me as a photographer, to keep my interest in photography and pushing my limits in creativity, this is important. And the last picture before the break, this is an owl photographed at night, and it's 4 second shutter speed. So the problem here, you know, is totally black, almost. So to focus with a 600 is difficult. So I have a LED lamp on top of the camera, so I can actually focus. And then I have a flash on the side, and that's a very powerful flash, because you cannot use a small flash in this situation. So I have 4 second shutter speed. The first second, the flash is released, and then I move the camera up toward the sky to get this kind of blue areas. So it's kind of first 1 second and then moving the camera. So these kind of techniques makes different pictures. And again, for me as a photographer, that makes it more interesting and more fun. Maybe nobody else likes it, but it's still a way to push limits and see what you can do. Because photography is not only photographing at 1,000th of a second. It can also include long shutter speed, as I did 100 years ago. Okay, so we take a break. How long break? 15 minutes. Yes. And then we take the last part of in the field, and also after the after you've taken a picture. Okay.
Ooh.
Okay. So the last part is shorter, but it's also maybe even more important. One of my best advice when photographing birds or small animals is to get down. Like here, it's tempting to photograph standing from 1 meter and 70 centimeter or whatever down, but then you will get the head and you will just see the bird down. If you get down on your stomach or have a flip screen so you can put the camera on the ground and you can see what you're photographing, you have a much closer contact to your subject. You know, you are at eye level instead of aerial photography. So this is very important. And also another thing with getting down, you increase the distance to the background. If I was shooting on a tripod down, this would be grass around, half sharp. Not a little bit blurred, but you could see a lot of disturbing grass. By laying down, the background has now moved hundreds of meters back and is totally blurred. And also there are some grass between the bird and the camera, making this blurred transition from the foreground to the bird. So getting down is one of the best advice I can give and something I do as often as possible. Another thing, when you get down, you can also get reflections. Sometimes when you see a bird swimming on the water, it's just water. But when you're getting down and suddenly the sun is reflected the same angle and you get the reflections. So sometimes when you're standing, it looks totally boring. When you're getting down, suddenly it's like magic. So just changing the position of the camera from 1.5, 2 meter and down can make a big, big difference. You can also add reflections. When you're low, the reflection from the wings, if I was standing, they will be gone. Because it's about the angle, this is like a mirror, so you have to get a low angle to get the reflection. Otherwise, it's gone. And that's why when I'm in Svalbard photographing polar bears, we use a Zodiac, which is an inflatable boat. So you get like 30, 40 centimeters above the surface. It's almost like being eye level when you have a polar bear in water or have a polar bear on the ice. It's almost like eye level. It's completely different than have a high standpoint and looking down. And when we're talking about reflections, you see here's a kind of weird situation. You have the eye 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 times because there are some small waves. And sometimes these waves can make really weird reflections, like this one. I posted this on Facebook a few years ago, and pretty much all the comments was, this is Photoshop. It's not possible. But yes, it's possible. I can show you the raw files, but it's a wave, a small wave here. So this is a reflection on the back of the wave. This is on the front, and this is the back. But there are so small movements, so you can't see it's waves. And of course, it's not every time it's a S. Sometimes it's a G or a oh. But sometimes you get some really interesting reflections. This is quite fast. This is 1600 or 2000. Yes, because this is about reflection. This has nothing to do about motion. It's only about reflection. How long do you want to where you stand? I'm standing here on the back of our boat. I showed the picture of the boat we're using earlier. So it's about 1.5 meter above the surface. And it's with a 600, and the distance is maybe from here to the wall, maybe 10 meter. And sometimes, I said, you have to get low. But sometimes you have to get a little bit higher to get the reflection. So it's all about the angle. If there's a bird on the ground, a small bird, you have to get down. If there are longer distance, you actually have to get a little bit higher. Yeah. So think about the position you need. My problem was that I wanted to get not only down to the surface, but I wanted to get under the surface, and like the split. So I started to use underwater housing, and it was handheld. So I had a walrus here, and I was holding the camera and hoping he would not use the tusks. These can be like 2,000 kilo, and next second he was like this with fisheye. And then I was thinking maybe I should make something to keep some distance. So I invented a pole cam system so I could have 1 or 2 or 3 meter distance. And I had autofocus and shutter release and a screen so I could photograph and be safe. And I could also use, this is actually photographing from beneath, and you would never do that without a stick or a pole cam, so you can actually have some distance and still get some crazy perspectives. But I've never seen anything like that before, because you need some special tool to do it. So I actually spent 2-3 years to learn like AutoCAD, and I did 3D printing to make the tools I needed, because you couldn't buy it. Couldn't buy this equipment. And also what I started to experiment with was different lenses. Usually use a 16 to 35 millimeter is kind of the universal lens underwater. But in this situation, I used a 85 at 1.4. It's a little bit crazy. But the thing I found out is when you shoot wide open, you have a very shallow depth of field. So the birds here are sharp and the edge of the iceberg, but everything in front is unsharp and everything in the back is also blurred. So this is actually underwater and it's a wave coming, but it's out of focus because of 1.4 and a small tele like 85 millimeter. So you might think this is a lot of Photoshop working and blurring and stuff, but this is pretty much straight out of the camera. And with this pole cam, I could also increase the length, so I had 2.5 meter. So I could stand on the boat, and I had the camera 2.5 meter down. And with the screen, I can have exactly the right, because it's just 1 centimeter up or down, and the whole split is destroyed. So you need to be very, very picky on the height in the water. So this is a project I'm working on, or called Living on Thin Ice. And the whole idea is most of the photographers photographing polar bears are always on the ice and talking about climate change. But you need to also show the decreasing thickness of this ice. So then you have to have this under and over the split. They're darker underwater than above water. So here you have to use the camera with high dynamic range, and I expose this as bright as possible. So I get some information here, and then I have to adjust this area. I have to expose it a little bit brighter in Lightroom afterward. shadows, exactly. I actually use a filter here in Lightroom just to bring it a little bit up. It's possible to use a split, natural split filter. It's possible, but then the thing with that, if you miss a little bit, you maybe get the transition here. That's not nice. You need it here. So with the new cameras today, the dynamic range is so great, so you can actually use it without flash and without the ND filter. I've used a lot of flash also, but it's, you know, it's quite heavy, and everything with flash underwater is hassle. It's nice, but if you can avoid it, that's good. Yeah. I have photo, but not with me now. You want to see? You send me an email, and I can show you a picture of the equipment. It's very nice. It's with carbon fiber and with 3D printed. But I made it for myself, but I also made a few for some of our clients joining our trip, because this is not. I don't sell this as a commercial product. It's a special tool. And sometimes you have an idea about what you want to achieve with your photography, but it's not possible because the equipment has not been made. So sometimes you have to actually make the equipment so you can take the picture you want. And that takes 3, 4, 5 years, because to develop this kind of equipment is a lot of testing, failing, and suddenly you have something that's working. So, but it makes it possible. I can shoot this situation safe with full control I see on the screen. And it's funny too. Another thing that is important is background. That's a very important part of the picture. And in this situation, the penguin is in shadow, but it was some light in the mountain in the background. So try to frame the bird in front of this glowing mountain. Of course, you don't see it's a mountain. It's just some kind of colors. But I always try to find backgrounds that are interesting. Like here also, it's something strange happening here. This is in Antarctica, Bailey Head, very special volcanic old ash. So I was framing the picture for the background and just waiting for some penguins to walk into it. And again, penguins are a blessing because they're walking, they have the highways, you know where they're going. So you just set up, 5 minutes later you have what you need. And also balancing background with foreground. And of course, it's never wrong with a polar bear or three in the picture. But what caught my attention here was this kind of wave with the reflection of the background, but it makes kind of a strange foreground. When you're talking about foreground, I also try to pay attention to shapes and structures. And of course, the polar bear was the main subject in the picture. But what I was most focused about was to align this kind of peaks with the background. It looks a little bit like the skyline in Dubai with the big, big towers. And sometimes you find that also in nature, really nice structures. This is it's very rare to have polar bears on blue ice like this. And it's tempting to use a telephoto lens to frame the bear as close as possible. But here I use a wider, it was like 70 millimeter, to also include the landscape. And just for fun, I submitted this picture for a European photo competition in the bird category. And it was one of the winners. And I talked to some of the judges after, and it was a big discussion because this is not the bird picture. Yes, it is. It's a very nice bird, actually. So sometimes it's nice just to test. And also here, kind of similar, it's a shape that's of course, the polar bear cub was the main thing, but I tried to frame it different to make it more interesting. I could have used a big lens to frame and itself, you know, it's a nice situation, a polar bear standing. But now it's an element in the landscape, and it's, in my opinion, a more interesting picture. Also with contrast, especially when we have snow, glaciers, and like here, almost like artistic background, and then try to frame the bear. Don't use the biggest lens, but include the surroundings. And sometimes I also make it black and white. So you have this high contrast with the snow and the areas without snow and birds. There's some birds here. So not big, but it makes it a little bit more interesting when you have the bird in this great big environment. Shadows and contrast. This is from our last trip to Antarctica, or actually South Georgia. This is after sunset, and the beach is in shadow. There's no sun on the beach. But there's still some colors in the sky after the sunset. So when the wave came up and went back, it was a reflecting surface. So the colors were really, really great. So this area was actually what I was most attracted by. So I put up my camera. There were no penguins there, but I knew, since there is a colony over there, I knew that at some point there will come some penguins. So I put up the camera, I framed the picture, and just waiting, and then they come. This is
you had a living monitor where you can see the scene, or
yeah, just the camera here. Just the camera, yeah. So I use a 600 and a Nikon D850 on this situation here. So I framed it like a kind of a nice landscape picture, but I was waiting for the penguin to make it even better. And contrast. This is early sunrise. And of course, again, it would be tempting to just make this as big as possible. But this area is what, in my opinion, makes it even more interesting. So it's very important to decide as a photographer what you include and what you exclude. That's a big part of a composition. And situations like this, it's not every day you have. So it's very important that you are know what you are targeting. And usually these pictures are not taken the first time you visit area like this, but maybe the second or the third. Because it takes some time to get ideas. And maybe you take a picture and you look it at the screen, and maybe it's good, but then you think, what can I do next? You go back, take other pictures, and it's kind of a process. And that makes photography more interesting, because you use your brain, and you use also your skills, and also the equipment. What caught my interest here was the white birds toward the dark bird cliff, and also the droppings, which also painted the dark rocks with white patterns. And also there are some lines here, so I very often look for contrast and also structures in the rocks like here. But my main thing in photography is backlight. I'm really, really, if I have a chance, I try backlight. And even here, it's a little bit stronger sun. Backlight is best at sunrise, sunset. But here, it's just been raining, so there are some droplets in the vegetation, and you get these reflections. And also the rim around the bears. Backlight with the reflections. It's important to shoot almost wide open, because when you start to close down your lens, you get more edgy circles. It's not circles, but it will be edges. So in this situation, I shoot wide open or almost wide open, 4.5, maximum 5, because more than that, you get these edges, which I don't like too much. You see here also, almost round. This is also 4.0 or 4.5. And the situation here is I'm following this walrus. The sun is straight behind. And there are waves splashing on the beach. And the droplets in the air is between the walrus and my camera. And when you have sun in the back and water, it will be some nice reflections. Sometimes you have silhouette possibilities. And then if possible, I like to try to hide the sun behind the subject or partly behind. Like here, you see the half of the sun is coming out. And also shadows. If I were using a flash here, I would kind of get fill light in the shadows, but it will be a completely different picture also. So sometimes I just don't use a flash because I want a different picture. Also with silhouette is, in this situation, it's a terrible foreground here. There are rocks, dirty rocks. It's not good at all. So here I was kind of underexposing by 2-3 stops. And then I got the silhouette. And also the setting sun made it really orange and nice. Sometimes you can use, by purpose, you can make your picture much darker. So you get this silhouette effect. But then also you need a backlight situation. Framing. Sometimes it's nice to frame the pictures. Like here is the penguin. Next second he's jumping in the ocean. And here I'm using an underwater housing. I have flash up in the ice above. It's kind of a strange situation. Usually the penguins have sky above. But here you have actually some ice with droplets. And also when photographing birds, you can frame the bird like this. And this is the ivory gull, and they are very connected to the polar bear because they are eating the leftovers of the polar bear kills, the seals. So they have a very close connection. So this is actually some of their habitat, but photographing them in between the legs is not the easiest part. And sometimes I like to photograph kind of daily life situation. This is a husband and wife arguing about something. And you see this person, he don't want to be included, he just want to leave. And you might have had this situation before. It's kind of daily life in our lives and also in penguin. There are some kind of arguing. I also have an ongoing project with photographing albatrosses with a heart. You see, it's the beginning here, but they should do it a little bit more tight here. So I've been maybe in 10 albatross colonies. I also framed with the stones here to make also this heart-shaped. And as you see, I've not achieved it yet. So it's an ongoing project. Just to tell you that you not achieve what you think. So now don't steal this idea. This is copyright. I trust you. But someday I will have it with the heart. Huh? Outside.
Outside.
Yeah, okay. But I need also inside. I need a double heart. So yes, it's close, but it's still an ongoing project. And that's good. You have to have the bar as high that you need to be try more and more. And when you finally achieve it, that's a very good. And being in advance, as I talked about, is also about waiting for the moment. You can't see it in the picture, but it's actually area in front of the bear, maybe 2 meters with open water. And we saw it, but low from the zodiac, it looks like it's ice all over. So we knew the polar bear is walking toward us, and we knew at some point he has to jump over this open water area. So here, by being in advance, be ready, and suddenly jumping, 1 second later, it's over. So you have to be ready, and you have to wait for the moment. And also, this is from my first trip to Svalbard, about 12 years ago. And there were 20 other photographers, and all of them had pointed the long lens in this area. There is a colony of seabirds, and I was thinking there must be something else. So I started to look around, and I saw that the sun at some point would be aligned with the cliff. And I also saw this kind of bird up in the sky, this cormorant in the sky. So I changed from my telephoto lens to the wide angle and took some completely different pictures than the rest of the group. And that's very important, that you're looking around and see if there's something else. And also be ready for the unexpected. Not every day a polar bear is taking a gull. And also here you have to be ready, because this is happening next second. It's a totally different situation. And focus. It's tempting to focus on the right, to the left. But now, with the bird, these also are very connected. And it gives a little bit interesting environment. You understand what it is, but it's not sharp. The brain has to work a little bit harder. Telling the story. I posted this picture on Mother's Day a few years ago. And you know, it's a story about the mother who is a newborn cub. It looks like it's dead. And she has to move it to a safer place because there were threats around. It was not our car that was the problem, but it was a big group of buffaloes. So the last thing in the field I want to advise you about is to pushing the limits. Because here is a situation, this is also at the river in Alaska. And the wolf came, and instead of using a fast shutter speed and get sharp pictures and safe pictures, I used 15th of a second panning and get some kind of effects, sharp and sharp. And in my opinion, this is, of course, the risk is that you lose the whole situation. Everything is blurred. But the reward is that you get something that you haven't seen before. So that's something I usually do myself. I try to take some safe pictures, and then I go and push the limits and do more artistic pictures, because I don't want to have thousands of sharp pictures or standard pictures. I want to have something different. Okay, so now I talked about in the field. And the big question now is what to do with the pictures. Because at some point there are a lot of pictures on the hard drive. And maybe some of you want to post it on Facebook or social media. Maybe somebody wants to hopefully print a book someday or participate in exhibition or a competition like HIPAA. And it's important, you know, if you want to make a book, for example, you also need to think how to take the picture for the book when you are planning the trip and also in the field. If you have photography as a hobby, you just want to take it and enjoy it, of course that's okay. But if you want to like have a winning picture in a competition, there are certain, it's a little bit different. You have to not only have a technical, very good picture, but you also have something extra. And I will talk about two things now in the end, and that's about competition and also pictures used. I will talk about the conservation project I'm involved in. And about competition, HIPAA has one of the biggest competitions. Next Sunday, I'm flying to London. I will be one of the judges in Wildlife Photographer of the Year in London, which is the biggest competition. And I will tell you, maybe give you some secret details. No. But I will show you a few pictures I've been awarded with and talk a little bit about it, so you maybe have an idea for winning HIPAA or other competitions. So this was the first picture I actually submitted, because before 2011 I had this idea that you are not a better photographer if you are winning a competition than before. And that's actually true, but it's also about recognition and also to prove you are a good photographer. So I submitted some pictures. This was the first one in the Wildlife Photographer of the Year. And why this was successful, I think it's because the environment, pay your attention, it's a snow blizzard. The lines are clean and also leading backward. And you have this snow making this blurred effect. It's kind of fading out. So it's something, it's not always easy to tell what it is, but it's something, some feeling, some kind of, maybe it's emotional, maybe it's something else, but it's at least a picture. It's a quite easy composition, but it's still a strong picture. Was it something here? No. And this also second place the same year in Wildlife Photographer of the Year. And what caught my attention in this situation was the sun, shadow in the field, maybe 2-3 kilometers in front of me. It was a kind of a tundra. And I didn't know exactly what it was, but it was like a magnet. I started to walk toward it, but there were nothing else. And then suddenly an Arctic tern flying around Most likely it was a nest someplace down. So I set up my camera, my tripod, and panning at fourth of a second, and then I got this kind of artistic, dreamy landscape. And the interesting thing is, this is one of my favorite pictures, but my wife don't like it very much because it's not sharp. And that's about panning. You will have some motion blur, but when you have at least something sharp, for me, that's enough. But I know not everyone like panning and motion blur. That's okay. But as a photographer, it's very important you take the pictures you like. And I like this, and I will continue. And if you don't like it, don't do it. It's very simple. This also was next year in a competition called GDT, that's European Wildlife Photographer of the Year. And it's, you see the pain. This is full contact. It's not cheating, it's really kicking the brain. And when you look at this, you might feel sorry for the fox. You do? But the problem here, the nest, these guys have been flying from Antarctica and 40,000 kilometers to the Arctic every year. They have a nest, eggs, and this guy has just stolen the eggs. They've been flying 40,000 kilometers and have to fly back, and he's very angry. And I'm sure everyone here would also be angry if we have done the same amount of distance and then for nothing. So actually, it's the Arctic tern, the bird we should be sorry about. It's not the fox. But it's kind of a situation that it's caught your attention. And also after this was published, I got email from National Geographic who wanted to film this, because this is kind of a situation. It's also nice for filming. This was my first successful underwater picture this was in GDT. And I think it's because of this kind of mystic kelp forest. You can see the birds, the penguins. Here I use the flash. And it's a different, it's a little bit different to see them in this kind of mystical, almost forest. Here, this is, I call this turbulence. And it's a blue whale, actually. Blue whale blowing, it's like 10 meter. The wingspan here is 1.5 meter. So it's about 10 meter up, and you also have this turbulence. So this bird is trapped in turbulence. When you're flying and have turbulence, it's not funny, but this guy is trapped in blue whale blow. So of course, when you're photographing here, you're not planning to wait until a gull is inside this. You just shoot. But what we did and always do when we have blue whales, fin whales on our trips, I tell the captain, backlight. We need to have the whale in front of the sun is to the left here. We need the backlight, because otherwise you will not see the water. You need the backlight to see the water. It's exactly the same in the next picture. It looks like it's snowing or raining, but it's actually feathers. This is the second biggest bird colony on Svalbard, about 200,000 birds. And they are synchronizing when the chicks are jumping from the cliffs. And they are fluffing the wings and trying to release all the downs. And with backlight, you can see them. Here, where there's no light, you can't see anything. You need the backlight. And also here you have some of the birds kind of making this contrast between the dark area and also the bride. And also you have a couple sitting in this kind of orange opening, making it more interesting. And again, backlight. This is a situation, it's cold, and it's like 20 degree minus. The bear is blowing, and then it's getting this kind of humidity. And backlight, you get orange-red color. Composition, very clean and easy. Not much information, it's just the bear. You can see a part of a glacier or something to the left. Just to show it's not in a zoo, it's actually in the wilderness. And then from the secret river, again backlight. Without backlight, you don't see the droplets. And also in a situation like this, it's just to shoot, because you don't know exactly which picture is the right one. Here you have it turning the head and it's kind of eye contact. Half a second later, it might be everything messed up. And this situation is kind of telling a story about climate change. It's a polar bear on glacier ice. That's not the ice the polar bear like, because there's not much seal on glacier ice. They like frozen or drifting ice. And it's kind of a dark background, kind of a sad setting. But it's also kind of a nice picture. But this was actually a picture. I had the overall Arctic photographer of the year, 2012. And I've shown you already some pictures with the Polcam system. And I think this was the second place in GDT last year. And I think it's because, you know, the jury has not seen this before. This Polcam system, seeing this split, is something totally new. And if you want to catch the attention to a jury, new things is very good. If they see something new, it's wow. And then they're taking the picture on the side, and it's these are keepers. So because when I'm going to London now, we have 4,000 pictures, and selecting the winner from 4,000 pictures. And all these 4,000 pictures are really good. So selecting 100 great pictures is very difficult. And then if you have something new, maybe that's the way to do it. And this was the winner in the Wildlife Photographer of the Year. And I had this picture in my mind for a few years. I want to take the picture of a bear on the ice floe in the landscape. But in this situation, we also had the footprints. The bear is walking to the left, to the right, to the left, and then it's looking back on me, and it's like asking, Where should I go? Where is the future? This is kind of the climate change. The ice is breaking up. The habitat, the environment is disappearing. And it was kind of an emotional moment. Where is the future? And that's a good question. Maybe we're all asking, I'm ready. I'm not sure. But for me, it was kind of asking for help. And I will end with some information about a project I've been working on for 4 years, polar bears and humans. Of course, I've been spending a lot of time photographing polar bears and connecting it with climate change. But at some point, I also realized that that's more happening. It's not only the climate change. And the thing is hunting. There are between 800 and 1,000 polar bears killed every year. And what shocked me is that nobody cares about it. It's okay. And so I decided to do research, not only use my photography, but also use my background in resource management, politics, actually to get information, also talk to the Inuit, talk to the people who has the history, who has been he has been hunting. And the problem is not the old traditional hunting for food, for clothes. But since 2006, the prices on polar bear skins rise 700%, and suddenly a polar bear skin is worth in China up to $90,000. That's like 1 kilo rhino horn, more than 2 kilo of cocaine, and then we have a problem, because now it's not subsistence hunting anymore, it's commercial. And the Chinese are now big, more than 70% are going to China, and nobody knows about it. Nobody cares about it, and then nobody do anything. So I'm publishing a book next month with 350 pages with information about what's happening, who is buying this, what the market situation, the supply demand, and about the future. And the thing is, or the main problem is not the number, but the commercial hunting is actually targeting the strongest, the biggest, and the healthiest animal with the best fur quality, because you get best payment. So the remaining animals, which should adapt to a climate without or with less ice, is the sick, the small, and the old polar bears. And that's very scary, because climate change itself is really bad, but adding what's left is scary. So one thing is the book, but I also working with a film team to make a film about the project. So I have a short teaser here.
My name is Ole-Jørgen Lioden, and I'm the founder of the Polar Bears and Humans Project. Climate change is a big problem for the polar bears and Arctic wildlife today. The sea ice is getting thinner and thinner, and the extent is decreasing. But another problem is a more direct human interaction. It's hunting. Today, about 800 to 1,000 polar bears are killed every year. Most of them in Canada, but also in Greenland and Alaska. And this is legal hunting. Hunters are targeting the strongest, most fit animals with the best fur quality. What's left to try to adapt to a warming climate is the sickest, the smallest, the oldest animals. It's not only about the number of polar bear kills, but what kind of animals are targeted. The time is now to act. We need to protect the polar bears for the future.
Okay, so the last 2 minutes before we open for the question part is also a spin-off project of the polar bears and humans, which I never talked about before because it's still a kind of a brainchild. But when I was investigating what's really dangerous, because a lot of especially media is telling polar bears is the most dangerous predator in the world. But if you look at the statistics, it's not true. So I was looking into what is the real dangers And like in Canada, it's not what the main problem. It's not poverty, it's not lack of jobs, it's not climate change, it's not drugs, not alcohol. But the main problem is actually suicide. And even worse, the more than 7 times higher suicide rate than the rest of Canada. And this was kind of heartbroken when I saw the most of them were between 18 to 25 years. And I started to ask myself, why? Why is this happening? And I started to read reports. I read people who had go through this. It's not easy to find because I don't want to talk about it. And the main problem is that they don't have a hope. And that's why because hope is a category in HIPAA. They don't have a hope. So how do we give them hope? How do we give the people growing up, the children, hope? So I've been thinking about a project called Generation Hope, where we give young children in the classes cameras. We give them some education, and they can use the camera to take pictures of nature, of wildlife, of culture, about the daily life, both the good thing and bad thing, and use photography as a way of getting hope. And already, this polar bear is photographed in a village called Kaktovik. It's only 266. And I talked to one guy who is quite good in photography. I want to pay him to teach some of the children. I also want to provide cameras. I will come back here 10th of September, and hopefully we can use photography as a tool to give them hope. And this is actually not new, because 10 years ago, I was engaged in a project in Norway where they wanted to use photography to help young people with psychological problems, suicide, to express themselves. So I made a book, you know, that took the pictures, because it's difficult to talk, it's difficult to write what's wrong, but photography or music can be a different language. So that's kind of what I want to do, to give them hope. Start with one village, teach them, give them some camera gear, and also have an exhibition that can go to the next village, and hopefully we can do this in other settlements very soon. And I hope and think that photography can be a tool to give them hope and realize the beauty around them, and maybe also express some of the bad things in their lives. So that's one of my brain children. It's not realized yet, but since hope is kind of the category in HIPAA, maybe there's somebody who wants to give hope, not only photograph hope. So that's what I want to say. Just in the end, if there are anyone who want to join on trips, I have a few catalogs. Also, we are cooperating with Post Trails. So if you have any questions, they can also answer. But if there's anything about equipment, about trips, about conservation, I'm available. Questions? Yeah.
often do you change your lens since it is always exposed for water and weather?
I usually have two